Good morning, and welcome to our Unitarian Universalist Cooperative Summer Worship Series for 2020. I'm Kendall Gibbons, Senior Minister at the All Souls UU Church in Kansas City, Missouri. When our congregations pivoted suddenly to online worship back in March, in response to the outbreak of the coronavirus pandemic, we all had to invent new formats and adapt to new technologies instantly. Many of our ministers and tech staff and volunteers rose to the occasion with great creativity and skill. Now, during our traditional summer break and study time, we take this opportunity to share our discoveries and learn from each other through a series of virtual visits to Sunday services with a cluster of our neighbor congregations. Through the gift of online worship, you will hear from some of our newest up-and-coming young preachers and some of our wisest senior colleagues. You will experience how a variety of congregations have embraced the challenges of these new formats, and our sound, video, and streaming tech folks will enjoy a little well-deserved time off. Look for our separate community online gatherings to resume in September. We hope that today's message will rouse your spirit and resonate with your soul.
With a message that lasts. noches viva la revolución. Home, home of the range, where the deer and the antelope play, where seldom is heard a discouraging word, and the skies are not cloudy all day.
I am Rev. Sarah Oglesby-Dunegan, she, her, hers. I'm the outgoing minister at the Unitarian Universalist Fellowship of Topeka, where I served for 6 years, and I'm the incoming interim minister at High Street Unitarian Universalist Church in Macon, Georgia. Today's service features performances and original music from Ana Marcela Maldonado Morales, Laura Dungan, Oshara Misha, Renee Brown, and Janine Silsby. Shelby Fehrenbacher and Ashanti Spears join me as worship associates today, and John Dunegan brings us the story of Guru Nanak. We're so glad to be sharing this service that features so many of our experiences in Kansas over the last 3 years, engaging protest as prayer. No matter what part of the country you live in or the struggles you and your community face, we hope that these words, music, and images will inspire you. One of the songs we sing says, "We are not afraid, we are not afraid, we will fight for liberation, 'cause we know why we were made." May you always remember and hear the call for liberation as a call home and a call to wholeness. Welcome to this Sunday service.
Morning, my name is Shelby Fehrenbacher, and my pronouns are she, her, hers. I am a state coordinator for the Kansas Poor People's Campaign and a facilitator for Families Belong Together. I attend Washburn Law School, where I am the president of the Advocacy Council and a student representing member of the Equal Justice Works Initiative. My activism work also includes pushing for Medicaid expansion in the state of Kansas and working towards police reform for more racially just Topeka. Within this activism work, protest is a major part of what I do in those roles. It's also really important to me as a mother who really wants to see a better, thriving world for my children, and as a future attorney who strives to fight against the corrupt parts of our system.
May our chalice shine all through the night. May our hearts be open, and may our minds be still. May our truth be spoken, and may our lives fulfill this promise of peace. This promise of peace, this promise of peace, this promise of peace.
Hi, my name is John Dunegan, and I'm here to do today's story for all ages. Guru Nanak teaches his people how to pray. When I was a little boy growing up in the Catholic Church, every night I had the same routine. Get ready for bed, brush your teeth, and then come into the bedroom, kneel beside the bed, and do my nightly prayers, which we'd start with the Our Father first, and then we would do Hail Mary, and then there was a chance to pray for other things. And typically being a little boy, those other things involved like praying for a new baseball glove or a new baseball bat, or even better, you know, a new bicycle. How great would that be? But now that I'm not that little boy, I realize that that's not quite the intention of prayer. That's not what we should be praying for, stuff. So this story is all about the right way to pray and the things maybe we should be praying for. And of course, this story starts as all good stories do, once upon a time, a long time ago, but not in a galaxy far, far away. Different story. Guru Nanak was traveling the country, teaching his people about a new way of being religious or being spiritual. You see, in this region, the Middle East region, at this time, you had Hindus and Muslims, but Guru Nanak kind of went beyond both of them and began a region that we now know today as the Sikh religion. This is about 550 years ago, so it's one of the younger of the major world religions. And Guru Nanak was traveling with people. One of his friends was a Hindu, and the other really good friend was a Muslim. And this was very strange for the time period because the two peoples did not get along. They did not like each other at all. Hindus did not like Muslims. Muslims did not like Hindus. In fact, it was during this travel, this time of travel, when Guru Nanak and his followers, including his two friends, entered this specific village. And the people said, well, Guru, we don't understand. This friend is a Muslim and this friend is a Hindu. So what are you? Are you a Hindu or are you a Muslim? And Guru Nanak answered the people by saying, you need to understand that there really are no Hindus and there really are no Muslims. And the people, not only were they confused by the answer, they didn't like that answer. He can't say there's no Muslims. And they went running off to the town mayor. And they, mayor, you won't believe what this man is saying. He's saying there's no Muslims and there's no Hindus. What do you think about that? And the mayor wasn't happy. He said gruffly, well, he can say it every once about the Hindus, but he can't say there's no Muslims because that's who we are. That's our religion. That's who we are. That's what we do. Guards, go and find this man and bring him to me. And the guards all strode out and they said, we'll find him. We'll bring him to you. We'll make him answer for these things he said. And they went to the town center, and they found Guru Nanak. And they were going to be all gruff and tough, and they're going to force him to come with them. But when they saw the Guru, and they saw how gentle he was with the people, they saw how respectful he was with the people, their attitude changed. Their attitude softened. They approached the Guru with the same respect and said, Guru, the town mayor would like to speak with you. Will you come with us? And Guru said, yes, you lead the way and I will follow you. And so the guards led him back to the town hall and back to the mayor. And when the Guru was in front of the mayor said, what is this nonsense you're saying about there being no Hindus and being no Muslims? I just don't understand any of this. But we Muslims are about to do our afternoon prayers. Will you pray with us? And Guru looked at the mayor and looked at the priest, the cleric who was there standing next to the mayor and said, yes. If you will lead the prayers, I will pray with you. And so the Muslims got out their prayer mats and they got down on their knees and they began their bowing and they began their chanting and their praying. And the Guru just stood there. Didn't seem to be praying at all. The mayor was noticing this as he was going through his prayers and was getting more and more upset as he just kept seeing the Guru just standing up, not praying and not seeming to do anything at all. So when the prayers were over, the mayor got up and he stomped back over to the Guru and says, you said you were going to pray with us and you didn't pray at all. You're supposed to be a spiritual person. You're supposed to be a man of your word. And Guru said to the mayor and said, Mayor, I said if you led the prayers that I would pray with you. But none of you were praying at all. Well, if we weren't praying, what were we doing then? And Guru turned to the cleric and said, cleric, you were thinking about that new baby foal that was born to you yesterday and hoping that it wouldn't fall in the well and hurt itself. And the cleric said, he's right. That is what I was thinking that whole time. Then Guru Nanak turned to the mayor and said, Mayor, you were thinking about those horses that you were going to sell today, all the money you were going to make from that sale and all the things you were going to buy with that money. And the mayor was kind of sheepish and said, yeah, that is what I was thinking about. So Guru, if we weren't really praying, how do you pray? And Guru Nanak said, remember these three things when you go to pray. Empty your mind. Pray from your heart, not from your mind. and let the light of God and love shine deep within you. And that is how Guru Nanak taught his people how to pray.
I invite you to take a moment to connect with your heart and body, to notice what is stirring in your heart and where in your body there are messages that you need to receive, to connect with the challenges in your life and the challenges of those you love and hold dear, to connect with the challenges of your community and people beyond your community whom you may never know, only know about, to connect with the environment around you, the rest of the living, breathing, growing, and struggling ecosystems of which we are all a part. In the chat, feel free to share the names of people and places that you hold in your heart now, whether in celebration and joy or in suffering and challenge. Whether you're facing deep-seated fears or uncovering wells of courage and simply finding your heartbeat and reminding who you are called to be in this moment.
Inside of you is a holy place, a temple, sacred space. Go there when you're tired. Go there when you're troubled. Go there when you have no place else to go. Just go there, go there. Just go there. Oh, raise your tent up to the sky. Inside of you is a holy place, a temple, sacred space. Go there when the world is tired. Go there when it's troubled. Go there when you think you know it all. Just go there, go there. Just go there. Oh, raise your tent up to the sky. Hard thing, you can do this. 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 Hard thing. Go there. Go there.
Seven of Pentacles by Marge Piercy. Under a sky the color of pea soup, she's looking at her work growing away there, actively, thickly, like grapevines or pole beans as things grow in the real world, slowly enough. If you tend them properly, if you mulch, if you water, if you provide birds that eat insects a home and winter food, if the sun shines and you pick off caterpillars, if the praying mantis comes and the ladybugs and the bees, then the plants flourish, but at their own internal clock. Connections are made slowly, sometimes they grow underground. You cannot tell always by looking what is happening. More than half the tree is spread out in the soil under your feet. Penetrate quietly as the earthworm that blows no trumpet. Fight persistently as the creeper that brings down the tree. Spread like the squash plant that overruns the garden. Gnaw in the dark and use the sun to make sugar. Weave real connections, create real nodes, build real houses, live a life you can endure. Make love that is loving, keep tangling and interweaving and taking more in. A thicket and bramble wilderness to the outside, but to us interconnected with rabbits, runs and burrows and layers. Live as if you liked yourself. And it may happen. Reach out, keep reaching out, keep bringing in. This is how we are going to live for a long time. Not always, for every gardener knows that after the digging, after the planting, after the long season of tending and growing, the harvest comes.
Colony. You observe cans of littered Coors Light and hear rap music being blasted from Volkswagens and Subaru Outbacks to count the new white people in Mama's Hood. It used to be Great Grandmama's Hood. When the empty house on the corner sheltered refugees of addiction, she dropped off blankets to some people that couldn't say their name into the darkness but led her to the light in this hood. There are songs pressed into pavement where precious children play in the day and listen to the tune of high-powered rifles ripple through their windows at night. Machine gun fire sounds like low property values. Loose dogs look like cheap labor lives in these parts. Unmanicured lawns eagerly await new neighbors. Down the street, you will find the people folks always look for. The good Negroes, the quiet Negroes with grown children that never ever visit home. There's the man whose job it is to make sure the hood has enough people that want internet that the colonizers like. He gathers signatures on the block where your cousins and them got shot. There's the other man surveying the lot that you live on, estimating the property value after demolition, hoping this home hasn't been lived in. A family for generations, choked by regressive tax policy, waiting for the next foreclosure, waiting for the next auction. You can count the white folks on the other side by no trespassing signs and Confederate States flagstaffs. When you walk by a yard with a barking dog, they might ask if the dog is okay. Just saw you standing there and thought you might be messing with the dog behind the fence, no? Just on my phone, you say. As the man turns and walks off, as if you said, thank you. Across the street from the gas station, a man might honk at you repeatedly, pull over, honk some more. He'll shriek while you keep a classical composure, knowing that you are not an object. You are walking away, trying to get home. What's worse? A don't tread on me car tag or broken beer bottles in the church lot where the children play. It could be worse, great-grandmama used to say. Some people can't walk at all, be grateful. I bet that was inscribed on the bullet that bit a high school student. The next headline subtext might say, "Don't come around here, little boy. Come on, build a new colony, colonizers, and watch great grandmamas deal with all of it, even if the mainstay of her resistance is securing a family and a house for generations."
It's not often that I find myself in what many coin as a state of devotion or holiness. It's no secret that I stray far from the line of what many call the good Christian. I don't attend church every Sunday, and when I do attend, I go to the most unchurched UU Fellowship in town. I don't bow my head to pray, and I often sit as far away from the pulpit as I can get. I don't volunteer to read passage, so you kind of get the point. My home life isn't much holier. Although I do have Torahs and Bibles, they mostly sit around collecting dust. I own a cross, but it's not hung up. I own a menorah and several chalices, but I couldn't tell you the last time that I used them. I've never taught my children to say their prayers before bedtime, mostly because I have never done that. And I don't thank God, Elohim, or the universe for the food that I eat daily. Though I'm not a devoted Christian or Jew, I am a devoted mother of four. I respect all living things of our universe greatly, and I feel a sense of deep obligation to care for the least among us. My moral compass does not allow me to rest for social injustices of this world, and I have been known to put myself on the line for others time and time again. For me, my prayers come through protest. In the moment that I step up and put my body on the line, I come into my holiness. My devotion for all those who are affected by the atrocities of our world, for all of those who Jesus would have never left to beg for basic humanity, and who the Messiah would surely deem worthy of being saved. For all those who are part of me and you and all of us in the internet-connected web of the universe. For me, my prayer sounds a little bit like this. Baruch Atai Adonai Eloheinu, dear God, universe, hear my prayer. As I place my body here in the line of danger, may it be enough. May we stand here together and feel the interconnectedness of our arms. May we be here because we believe in a better world, a world where we are all treated equitably. May this moment turn into a movement. May we bring progression. May we bring hope. May the oppressors see a new way. May our opposition see us as human. May we stay safe. May I return to the loving arms of my children tonight. And if I don't, may it not be in vain. Blessed be. Amen.
Hear our prayer. We want health care.
Somewhere.
Are you in order? You bring him out here. I will stay right here.
There is more. Got a right to live. Everybody's got a right to live. And before this campaign fails, we'll all go down to jail. Everybody's got a right to live. Sing with me. Everybody's got a right to live. Keep singing. Everybody's got a right to live, and before this campaign fails, we'll all go down to jail. Everybody's got a right to live.
Since the fall of 2014, when I began ministry in Topeka, Kansas, I have joined many groups and organizations in many different forms of protest and public prayer. Lamenting and protesting the deaths of Black and Brown folks of all gender identities and ages, some who lived in other cities, and some who lived right there in Topeka. Lamenting and protesting gun violence aimed at people in gay clubs, and children in schools, and people in concerts, people in their neighborhoods going about their own lives. Lamenting and protesting the lack of health care access and the extensive mismanagement of foster care and harm to youth in our state. Lamenting and protesting the impact of climate change and the lack of clean air and water. Sometimes the gathering was primarily a prayer, a gathering of people in a public space to share pain and stories, to publicly decry the impact of an event or a policy. Sometimes it was primarily a protest, a rally meant to create media and bring attention to a policy or a situation, to make demands and bring the voices from the margins to the center. There have been times and places where I experienced transformative, courageous love and witnessed its power. It worked within me and spread around me. I was and we were both conduit and generator. It made me feel brave and powerful. It channeled my anger and my ambivalence into action and words and commitments. As Reverend Rebecca Parker describes this love in an essay in A House for Hope, this love is dangerous. We advocate for love that surprises, disrupts and alters the status quo, that expresses itself in diverse ways, that comes in rainbow colors. This love is based on a kind of human permaculture, a garden planted not in straight rows of monoculture, but a teeming diversity of lives planted in ways that complement one another and make best use of all resources at hand, that wastes nothing, and that creatively conserves the resources needed. As poet Marge Piercy puts it in her poem, Seven of Pentacles, a thicket and bramble wilderness to the outside, but to us, interconnected. So my questions are, how can we learn to do justice as an act of love, a relationship first, rather than just a set of tasks and logistics? How can we learn to collaborate and build partnerships to share the work and broaden our scope? How will we, Unitarian Universalists across this country, help build a beloved community made up of circles of courageous love, where we sing together and act together, connected in our hearts, as we move toward the world we hope to shape and move? My first memories of a circle of courageous love come from my mother's work as an activist with the National Organization for Women and Women's Rights. Reproductive rights, equal pay, human rights. I watched her at rallies and I marched with her. I sat in meetings and I listened to her talk to her friends and colleagues. I helped stuff envelopes and helped fold newsletters. I learned that when you believe in something, when you want to make a difference, you don't do it alone. You create a circle of allies and friends, and you keep welcoming more people into the circle. I see the threads of this work in all of the organizing I have engaged since then, from working with tenants in Dallas to the Poor People's Campaign in Kansas. Now we live stream our conversations and our protests, and we do political education online, and we meet via Zoom. Never solo. Forward together, not one step back. 20 years ago, I visited El Salvador to learn more about microcredit programs, and I was moved by the tenacity and vision of women running small businesses in solidarity with one another, creating a wide network of women anchoring communities and families on multiple levels. In January 2019, I helped gather a circle of people together in Topeka to welcome a family of asylum seekers from El Salvador to Topeka. We came together to support a family of four, now five, and after ending their journey of 1,000 and more miles, mostly covered by foot over the span of a year, the young mother asked me, "Where do you go to dance?" Where do you go to dance? Through the stories about their journey with the caravan and thousands of others in Central America and their journey to escape violence and death threats in El Salvador, this family has taught me about persistence and endurance. And like the woman that I met 20 years ago in El Salvador, this family has taught me to be audacious and to never lose sight of opportunities for joy. Our circle in Topeka encouraged other congregations and communities to also sponsor families and welcome asylum seekers. And many others have engaged in this work. There's always a new chapter, a new opportunity around the corner, inviting us to reimagine what it is to be audacious. In college, I found another circle of courageous love working with a grassroots organization called Results that lobbied for funding of programs that address the worst aspects of hunger and poverty. We started a group at my UU congregation, and I fell in love with this organization because they were nonpartisan and they always sang songs together. They did this before they went to lobby in DC. Really. At their national conference, Results members gathered in a large room on the Hill to sing things like, "Shower the people you love with love. Show them the way that you feel." And then they would go lobby. They'd talk to representatives about programs like Head Start and WIC and UNICEF and microcredit programs. And I bet they were the only group that entered lobbying by singing first. They started from an assumption of relationship instead of animosity. And I found that singing together is also an act of courageous love, one that strengthens the circle. Many years later, I found that same courageous love in the work of the Poor People's Campaign,
singing in the halls of political decision-making, and anchoring direct action with our shared voices. I moved from advocacy to organizing and protest because the voices that most needed to be heard weren't being heard. Because we needed to learn to follow those most impacted by the policies and programs we were seeking to change. We sang, "Somebody's hurting my people and it's gone on far too long." And we sang, "Went down to the rich man's house and I took back what he stole from me." As Reverend John Burens puts it in his essay, The Welcome Table, it is about having the faith that we can together feed the many who are hungry, because just as Jesus is said to have fed 5,000 with two fishes and a few loaves of bread with plenty left over, we need to operate from an awareness of abundance, not a model of scarcity. In Marge Piercy's language of the garden, we are called to penetrate quietly as the earthworm that blows no trumpet, to spread like squash that overruns the garden, and to gnaw in the dark and use the sun to make sugar. This kind of love knows no violence except drought and inattention, weeds that invade. This kind of love requires presence and planning, but also relationship and diversity, plurality. Several years ago, in an interfaith prayer circle inside the Colorado Capitol, another circle of courageous love was forming surrounding young immigrant dreamers. A group of Unitarian Universalist lay leaders and ministers joined from faith leaders all across Denver. Some of us had not seen prayer as an integral part of justice work before, but that day we experienced something holy and unifying, and understanding that who we are being and the relationships we engage shape the work we do. We are learning that we must build coalitions and collaborate, that our work demands a wide circle of partners with many perspectives, many talents, many ideas. We are learning to side with each other and to companion one another, and yes, to follow. A few years later, I joined Kansas Interfaith Action, whose work has been anchored in social justice demands for change and faith traditions who have a vision of beloved community. This work has reclaimed the religious frame as larger than the political conservative brand of Christianity dominating our country. It has made room for Muslims and Jews and Buddhists and Unitarians and Christians who have rejected the version of Jesus that would justify deepening economic and racial divides. We have prayed from these many traditions and many spaces in our capital, including prayers that were also protests. Prayers that were interrupted and interrupted the proceedings of a body unwilling to address the deep divides in healthcare, the needs of people underrepresented in the building, and its decision making. As we've done this work together, we've deepened our connections to one another and learned that this is also integral to the work that we do. As activist and writer Bell Hooks so eloquently says to us, the struggle to end racism and the struggle to end sexism are naturally intertwined. To make them separate is to deny a basic truth of our existence. Indeed, Bell Hooks tells us that this struggle has significance only if it takes place within a feminist movement that has as its fundamental goal the liberation of all people. Reframing feminism and anti-racism as related issues, not separate, also helps us connect to other oppressed communities. This is why protest is a form of prayer. Protest in its many forms is how we remind ourselves that all of us have inherent worth and dignity, and that we have a responsibility to fight for salvation in this life, for all of us. It's how we recollect ourselves into the work of building beloved community and reconnect with the sacred power that is vibrant and life-giving. Protest is fundamentally contextual. We may act on our own, but we are never alone. We may protest for our own needs, but the needs we have are shared by so many others. For me, it's always about my vision for the future and for what community can look like and what it can be. For wholeness and healing and access to what humans need to be whole and healed. So it's always an expression of prayer for redemption, for change, for salvation in this life. Building a movement has meant building relationships and knowing each other's stories, knowing the context we are each bringing with us. Protest and prayer alike challenge us to see beyond the authority of systems and demand justice from a larger collective power. Something greater than the sum total of each of us and all of us. Something we create and connect to that reminds us that life is bigger than this moment and bigger than the current systems that we've created. Theologian Paul Raiser describes the current social paradigm as a shared belief in autonomous individualism, which is a poor foundation on which to build a deeper sense of community. Amen. Moving away from this rampant individualism is necessary to access courageous love. The idea that we can be independent instead of the reality that we are interdependent is an erroneous idea, says Raiser. He corrects this with the idea that myself is not just connected to the other, but completed by the other. And this tells us that we are called to account by the other who co-constitutes us. Our connections to one another are multifaceted and infinite. These connections are God. In this current moment, as we grapple with a pandemic that ravages our communities and deepens our divides, we are experiencing a devastating lack of leadership across the country and an emphatic uprising against the systemic violence of white supremacy within every institution in our country. And protest is a growing and shared prayer. It is an invitation to community. It is an opportunity for redemption. When we take a knee together, we remind each other that our lives are sacred and our bodies and labor can. Not be used to control us. We must fight to create a country that understands reparations and learns from the past. Courage is not just about overcoming fear. Courage is about tapping into a life-affirming energy. For some people, that is God. For some of us, it's the collection of our efforts on behalf of one another and falling in love with life. Author and speaker Brené Brown talks about this essential quality that's needed to access deep connection. The ability to be vulnerable, to feel deeply, and to engage all of what life brings to our doorsteps. Courageous love comes from a place of vulnerability and mystery, where we don't know how things will turn out and we can't avoid suffering. Brené Brown says that vulnerability is our most accurate measure of courage. We practice this when we sing, when we pray, when we hold hands, when we disagree, and when we protest. Vulnerability is essential to being open and willing. We are learning to be vulnerable together and to reframe strength. Protest is an act of courage that makes us both vulnerable and powerful. Prayer is also an act that makes us both vulnerable and powerful. When we see the two merge, we see each other and our circle of courageous love as a new kind of gardening, planting the seeds of change and tending to their growth. My hope for myself and for Unitarian Universalism, for our communities and our nation, is that we will create circles of courageous love, knowing these lessons of justice work. Don't do this work alone. Dare to be audacious. Strengthen the circle with song and prayer, and side with communities facing oppression. I hope these will be circles where we begin and end in song or prayer or meditation or quiet empathy or dancing or locking arms together and protecting one another. No matter what our task is, no matter what our disagreements, no matter how vulnerable we may feel in that moment, I hope that when the going gets tough, we will schedule a little extra time to sing, to share stories, a little extra time to breathe and reflect before we re-enter our shared work. And we will know that this is the work because courageous love will transform the world. I hope you will begin to see us as a connected community of congregations that share history and values, that are engaged in similar work with each other. We need to be connected to each other and to other organizations and communities and to other leaders in each of our locations, but we also need to be engaged with each other across the country. There's so much more power and opportunity when congregations see themselves as working in concert rather than in isolation. This year, we face incredible crises in our communities. And we are invited to UU the vote and to engage in many kinds of organizing and protesting and prayer. As Carter Hayward says, love, like truth and beauty, is concrete. It is not fundamentally a sweet feeling, not at heart a matter of sentiment or attachment or being drawn toward. Love is active, effective, a matter of making reciprocal and mutually beneficial relation with one's friends and enemies. Love creates righteousness or justice here on earth. To make love is to make justice. What does courageous love look like in your life, in your congregation and your community, in the greater world? When have you felt deeply moved by love, not just anger, to act for justice and the salvation of humanity here and now? What would you be willing to do for love? Through courageous love, I am moved to honor a sacred interdependence. And I propose that it is this love which brings us into intentional community, despite our cultural individualism and our tendency towards atheistic independence. It allows us to see the shackles of white supremacy in every aspect of our lives. We recognize that we are called to act on behalf of the whole, on behalf of our own yearning for wholeness and healing. Ask yourselves, what is stopping us? What does love call you to do to heal, to transform in yourself and in this world that you were an integral part of? Take a look at your neighbors everywhere you go today and this week. How might you act in concert with one another for a better world for all of us? Piercy writes, live as if you liked yourself and it may happen. Reach out, keep reaching out, keep bringing in. This is how we're going to live for a long time. Not always, for every gardener knows that after the digging, after the planting, after the long season of tending and growth, the harvest comes. Are you willing to enter this prayer of protest, these protests that are prayers? Blessed be.
justice, no peace. Hear them crying, I can't breathe.
Say their names, say them loud. Black lives matter, black pain matters. Black power is magic, and one day we won't have to fight this war.
To be the living embodiment of our principles, to be about the work of building the beloved community, to be a people of intention and a people of conscience. Blessed be.
We are a gentle, angry people, and we are singing, singing for our lives. We are a gentle, angry people, and we are singing, singing for our lives. We are a justice-seeking people, and we are singing, singing for our lives. We are a justice-seeking people, and we are singing, singing for our lives. We are young and old together, and we are singing, singing for our lives. We are young and old together, and we are singing, singing for our lives. We are a land of many colors, and we are singing, singing for our lives. We are a land of many colors, and we are singing, singing singing for our lives. We are gay and straight together, and we are singing for our lives. We are gay and straight together, and we are singing for our lives. We are gentle, loving people, and we are singing for our lives. We are a gentle, loving people, and we are singing for